brought to you by Penguin.
Gloves Off by Tyson Fury. Read by Tyson Fury and Jake Wood. Warning. Sensitive content. This book contains depictions of a suicide attempt and suicidal thought, and may be troubling and triggering for some listeners. If you have been affected by mental health problems and have experienced or are experiencing suicidal thought, please get professional help immediately. This book draws on my personal experiences, and I hope you may find some of my approaches to mental health useful. But what works for me will not work for everyone, and I am not an expert, so you may require medication and medical help. The author and publishers disclaim, as far as the law allows, any liability arising directly from the use or misuse of the information contained in this book. Introduction. The Legend of the Gypsy King.
This is the story of an abnormal life. So take some time to say hello to the Gypsy King. You're undefeated, undefeatable, heavyweight champion of the world, a gladiator with all the swag of an American knockout artist, plus the skill chops shown by the greatest European prize fighters, and the pain threshold of a bare-knuckle warrior. No doubt, God bless me with a lot, a sledgehammer jab, dancing feet, and a fearless attitude that allowed me to destroy my rivals during a powerhouse career featuring 33 fights, 32 wins, 0 losses. Yeah, my matrix experienced a glitch with a 2018 draw against Deontay Wilder, but that's never bothered me. I've long been the admiral of HMS I Don't Give a Fuck, the most entertaining showman since the days of Muhammad Ali, the greatest fighter of my generation. And being good-looking hasn't harmed me any either.
23rd of April, 2022. Wembley Stadium. Fury v. White. It was showtime, Dossers. And the arena went crazy. Lights and camera flashes flickered around the crowd. Lads threw pints. Women screamed my name. And who could blame them? This was a showdown for the history books. A bout against the British heavyweight Dillian the Body Snatcher White at a Ramo Wembley Stadium heaving with 94,000 punters. The biggest ever crowd for a European boxing match. After 2 years of pandemic misery, the country was thirsty for a massive party. And the Gypsy King was going to give them one. The hype had been so big that ticket sales for Fury v. White outsold some of the most famous names in pop music. Making an entrance to remember on a night like this was a big deal, so I was carried into the arena on a gold throne. And as I was hoisted into the air, I felt like a master of the universe. This is the superstar atmosphere I've always enjoyed as a boxer, and the experience of connecting with it has always been surreal and incredible. At that moment, I became supercharged, like I'd been plugged into the electrics and my adrenaline soared. Not bad for an old fat fella, I thought, looking around at the craziness. A bald-headed lad from Morecambe, a seaside town in the middle of nowhere. But even though I was partying too, my eyes were still fixed on the prize. I needed a win to match the pizzazz. I'd picked a soundtrack to match the mood and it rocked through the Wembley PA. The first cut was Sex on Fire by Kings of Leon, a song that had often helped me to find a groove in training. I belted it out with everyone in the stadium, like we were pals in a karaoke pub or celebrating an England win in the World Cup. The second song, Juicy, by rapper the notorious B.I.G., a.k.a. Biggie Smalls, was there because its lyrics, "It was all a dream," reminded me of my own life. Being Tyson Fury was like a dream. In Biggie's case, he'd read hip-hop magazines as a kid, listened to rap radio and stuck pictures of his heroes to the bedroom wall before becoming a legend. I'd been the same, but with boxing. I'd watched the fights, read about the great heavyweights, and tacked photos of my heroes around the place. Some people told me I wouldn't make it as a fighter, and the same had been said to Biggie about his music career, but neither of us had listened to the critics. We'd both reached for the stars instead. And tonight, I was ready to shine. The crowd seemed to whirl around me like leaves in a hurricane, and I was the eye. As the noise for my final entrance continued to build, I knew that these were my people, and this was my moment. The 9-year-old version of myself would have loved the buzz and the colour. so soak up every second of it, pal, I thought. And when I saw the ring ahead, it was hard not to think about what would happen to the boxing world once I'd left. Who could fill this void? At that point, retirement was on my mind and about to become a major talking point. But if I walked away for good, the sport would probably return to how it was pre-Gypsy King, full of boring fighters that very few people cared about. The papers were going to miss me too. I only had to crack open a can of lager or walk into a pub with my shirt off for them to write a front-page headline. These were the nights I lived for. I was like a gladiator striding into his arena, and it was hard not to feel a sense of pride, because my contest with White seemed like so much more than a boxing match. That had a lot to do with the date. 23rd of April, St. George's Day, a moment in the calendar that means a lot to me, because I'm very proud of my roots. Fury v. White was an all-English clash too, a moment in national sporting history, and you know how us English do when it comes to a battle. We hold our shit down. Psychologically, the fact that I was fighting on home turf for the first time in years was a motivational boost. It was a death or glory clash, and I wanted to do everything in my power to bring a buzz to the nation. For this momentous occasion, I was wearing a white and red robe, England colours. I'd also heard a person could look much bigger than they actually were when dressed in white, thanks to a trick of the eye, in much the same way that wearing black creates a slimming effect. To my opponent, I must have looked humongous, like a 6'9" monster, and terrifying, because I'd picked a pair of specially designed St. George's Cross boxing gloves for the battle, a fist wrapped in a flag. My plan was to smack White in the mouth so hard that the country would be shaking for days afterwards. Some people were doubting my chances of winning, but no way was I messing up at Wembley Stadium, and to make sure, I ran through my usual pre-match routines during the build-up. In the dressing room, I moved about in my underpants, singing and dancing, cracking jokes, only stopping to take a seat on the massage table to watch the undercard and have my hands wrapped. I've studied boxers my whole life, as both a fan and a fighter, and knew that before a title bout I was unlike a lot of the others. Stress ricocheted off me, even in a venue as big as Wembley Stadium, and I liked to mess about with the music cranked loud. I've seen many other changing rooms throughout my career, and most of them were like death parties. You'd think the boxers involved were going under the guillotine. Blokes were pale and panting. They shook with nerves and punched the walls as a way of firing themselves up. Everyone alongside them looked frazzled with terror. But not me. Not in my space, and definitely not at Wembley. I was a disco diva getting ready to shine. I was about to get paid and about to get laid, and I loved having the cameras and the press around me in the dressing room because it added to the sense of occasion. During those moments, I could tell what everybody was thinking. Why is he acting like this? He's going out there to fight a man who could potentially kill him with one punch. He just doesn't give a damn. But that's what sets me apart from most people in life. Giving a damn is not my thing, and knowing my resolve won't wobble under pressure, I have every confidence my body won't falter either, no matter the challenge. The faith that I can withstand all punishment then creates even more self-belief in what is an ever-expanding circle of positivity. Wembley, though being my biggest ever fight, was no different. I was ready to go. I ran through a warm-up with my dad John alongside me, plus my trainer Sugar Hill Stewart, a former Detroit policeman and a nephew of the Boxing Hall of Fame trainer, Emmanuel Manny Stewart, and a nutritionist, George Lockhart. Together we moved through some pad work. Bang, bang, bang. Everything felt nice and easy, though I wasn't overconfident or in a massively cocky mood. I always took precautions, and as I got myself together for the walk into Wembley, I pulled my team about me for a group prayer. Dear Lord, please give us strength and the ability to go in there and give our best performance, I said. We pray for the opponent to do exactly the same. And most of all, we pray that both men can come out in one piece and go home to their families. The time to rock and roll had arrived. My boxing life has been made up of two careers. The first took place between 2008 and 2015, a period in which I was unable to recognise the psychological demons dragging me down. They pulled on me like a rucksack full of stones, despite the fact I was on my way to becoming the heavyweight champion of the world. The second career kicked off in 2018, after a brutal battle with my mental health, a war I'm still locked into today. Through sheer will, I was able to overcome my issues and return as the planet's most entertaining pugilist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.